Simon & Schuster Audio presents I'm Over All That and Other Confessions by Shirley MacLaine. Read by the author.
This is the Overture. All life, even the cruelest drama and most absurd comedy, is a form of show business, a kind of performance. And I've been lucky enough to have created the moving picture show of my own life. I've starred in it, produced it, written it, directed it, even financed and distributed it. What's even better is that I get to rerun it now and then, to see things I might have missed back then. In this third act of my life, much has become clearer. So much is over, and I am over so much. I have learned to ease up on worry, scheming for films or roles, planning for better surroundings, and feeling anger at all our leaders who operate politically rather than humanely. Yes, I'm over all that. I'm over listening to advertisements, the latest fashions. I never was much for that. Events I should attend in order to be seen. Red carpet madness. I'm getting more and more free from the expectations of the external world. In fact, the one worry I can't seem to give up and get over is a lingering fear that being a reclusive, happy, older woman may not be entirely healthy, but who says so? I'm not interested in parties or new outfits, only comfortable ones, or being socially acceptable, and whether I'll be on anyone's so-called A-list. My goodness, what a way to live. I'm not over going to the movies, seeing live theater, hearing symphonies of music, eating a good dinner. I'm learning to dine out alone. Attending a worthy charity event for half an hour. Visiting a sick friend or taking treats and toys to the animal shelter. I am over what other people think. Got over that a long time ago. And trying to persuade them to come around to my point of view about anything. One thing will always be a constant with me. I have a guiding sense of curiosity. I will never get over asking why. This questioning has been with me all my life. It's my sustenance, my inspiration, my joy, and my intellectual food and color. I will never be over my search for the big truths. And I'm not the only one. Most people I've met around the world believe we are not alone in the universe, but will not talk about this openly because they're terrified of being humiliated publicly for their beliefs. Some scientists, academics, and movers and shakers I've met were even reluctant to discuss it privately because of how they might be perceived. Just another reason I revere the brilliant and fearless Stephen Hawking. Everywhere I've traveled in the world, I've found that people are looking for something to fill the loneliness inside them. They are after what I think of as the big truth. It doesn't matter how wealthy or well-situated they are. After service talking and joking, eating, Hollywood gossip, and cultural politeness, the conversation always turns to why are we here? What is the point of life? Is God real? Are we alone in the universe? That's because, like me, most people have realized that money isn't the answer to their emptiness. In fact, it sometimes contributes to it because the management of money, or the fear of not having enough, distracts them from any real examination of what is really bothering them. So I've concluded that for us to get to the bigger truths, there is much for us to get over. I've had a good time exploring what I've finally gotten over and what I will never get over, from the ridiculous to the big sublime. I'm glad I'm in the third act of my life. I've loved my ride, and I'm now appreciating relinquishing the reins and looking back. Sometimes I feel an unbearable ecstasy of loneliness for some of my past, wishing now that I had been so much more present then. Sometimes I feel it all happened to someone else, and I long to get the me of it all back. How could I have done so much, been so many places, known so many people, and now it's all gone? It's past. Memories of colorful stories like little movies attached to the celluloid of my brain tissue. Every now and then, the little movies turn themselves on, wanting to be rerun. What didn't I see then? What deeper meaning did I miss? Where are those actors and actresses and politicians from my past now? They are still with me in all the things they taught me, the memories of the times we shared. Fascinating and talented people, mind-expanding conversations, and curiosity about the future. Those are things I will never get over. So, on with the show. I'm not over my need to know. When I look back on my 76 adventure-peppered years of life, I want to celebrate my still-here-ness. While I am definitely more still now, I do like being here. One of my great passions in life was traveling, which I'm sorry to say that's not true anymore. I'm over all that. I like being here where I am, and I like being still. The idea of walking through an airport in a state of terror over the idea that the TSAs, thugs standing around, won't let Terry, my terrier dog, on the plane with me, is my worst nightmare. What has happened to us? We obediently cower in fear, hardly even made uneasy by the thing that should really scare us, our own acceptance of the foregone conclusion that the possibility of terrorism trumps our freedom to travel. I'm over that conclusion. I don't believe that terrorism is the real reason we've become saluting robots. I believe we have neglected to see that terrorism is just a convenient excuse for those in power to gently instruct us to go quietly into that good night of being compliant and unrevolutionary citizens who willingly become subjugated to authority. Thomas Paine has always been my idol. He wrote of the common sense of starting a revolution and praised the age of reason instead of religion. Of course he's buried in a potter's field somewhere where no one can pay respects. He flew too much in the face of accepted behavior, which didn't sit well with those whose first priority was political popularity and maintaining the status quo. People like that tend not to be the ones who get the big memorials and shrines dedicated to them. The blood of the Founding Fathers runs through my veins because I was born and raised in Virginia, the real birthplace of our American Revolution. It was also the place of metaphysical leadership, the Masonic Order. But there will be time for words like metaphysics later. I got over the box-type religious thinking a long time ago, too, because I wanted to breathe. That is what freedom is for. I find it interesting and more than coincidental that I developed asthma during the W. administration. I was so frustrated with his idiocy and perpetuation of harm that I literally couldn't breathe. I ended up in the emergency room 3 times, and each time I felt what it must be like to die of asphyxiation. I felt the land of the free was becoming asphyxiated too. People were so dumbed down they didn't even realize they weren't in charge of their own lives or their own thoughts anymore. Whether 9/11 was planned by people other than Osama bin Laden and Al-Qaeda, I don't know. But it certainly was conducive to the endeavor of dispensing with our individual freedom, which was supposed to be our inalienable right, and the defense of which should be the primary reason we would ever go to war in the first place. We were told we should patriotically fight and kill those who would rob us of our freedoms. We didn't need Osama. We allowed it to happen by not questioning our own elected leaders, who said national security should be our highest priority. For me, the searching of my bags and the patting down of my body and my dog is unconstitutional. Once in Los Angeles, a big, fat, slovenly guy made me walk back and forth with Terry, 26 pounds, 4 times through security because my boarding pass was turned the wrong way. I found myself hissing like a cat and hating these authoritarian men who were exercising their power over me, a well-known and admittedly privileged woman. I heard he got fired later. Maybe he picked on Rosie O'Donnell. Traveling for me is a constant reminder here and abroad that we are becoming afraid of ourselves and our neighbors. Because fear is the most powerful weapon of mass destruction. I don't want to get over my abhorrence of such a condition. I am over-traveling, except when absolutely necessary, or unless a Pleiadian spacecraft offers me a ride to a planet where they claim to have solved such matters. I hate that I'm over-traveling because of all this security bullying. It was a multi-layered experience for me everywhere I went before.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.